Hello, and welcome to everybody tuning in remotely at this year's South by Southwest Festival. My name is Sarah Fisher. I'm the media reporter at Axios, and I'm joined by a stellar array of talent in the newsletter space. Today's panel is about the new flagship media product, newsletters. We have a lot of great conversations ahead, so let's get started. I'd like to first introduce the three people I'm talking to: Alex Lieberman, the CEO and co-founder of Morning Brew; Millie Tran, the chief product officer of Texas Tribune; and Jed Legum, the founder and author of Popular Information. Alex, I want to get started with you. We've seen over the past few weeks, there's been a lot of momentum in tech platforms building newsletter infrastructure, whether that's Twitter or Facebook, Substack, Forbes, and others. You obviously started an independent newsletter company. You didn't go through any of those offerings. Why choose to go independent, and what do you make of this sort of newsletter tech rush?
Yeah, for sure. Thanks for having me. Well, I think, you know, this newsletter tech rush is part of a broader trend to unlock the value of the creator economy. If the internet has done one thing that's been really powerful over the last 5 years, it has been allowing for tools to be created to enable creators. And I think it's an incredibly powerful thing. You know, candidly, when we started Morning Brew at the time, we didn't know about any of these tools, or a lot of these tools didn't exist. So that's the honest answer of why we didn't start with any of them. But I think it's such a great route for early creators to go, whether it's using Substack, whether it's using Review, any of these platforms. I do think a big challenge that any of these platforms will have to think about is, once you get big enough, what is maintaining lock-in, where you don't just go and build the thing yourself when you have enough revenue coming in the door?
So I want to just quickly follow up with you on that. You said that when you started Morning Brew, a lot of these platforms don't exist. Now they do. So what does that mean as a competitive advantage or disadvantage now that you're a few years in? Are you worried that there's going to be a newsletter onslaught that you're going to have to compete with? Or do you think you are differentiated in that you didn't go through one of these platforms?
Yeah, I think it's a great question. I think we have definitely seen more in the way of newsletters being created today than they were 5 years ago. My fundamental belief is, I think it's a good thing for Morning Brew and anyone in the newsletter space. Similar to podcasting, I think the more that people talk about newsletters, it's a rising tide that lifts all boats. And to us, we're not competing just with newsletters. We're competing for people's attention with quality content. So the thing that I think we should hold ourselves accountable to is creating great content that keeps people in the newsletter experience, where newsletter is the destination, not a content marketing tool. And if other people want to play in the space, that's awesome. But we're focused on just great content serving a very specific audience. And that's the only thing we can control, you know, ourselves.
I'm going to come back to you a little bit more about Morning Brew, because I think a lot of people are going to want to hear more about your journey. But let's pivot to Judd. Judd, your Popular Information newsletter is really a true success story. You've been quoted in Bloomberg as, you know, making a good amount of money off of it, and it's sustainable. But I've told you this before, I think you are one of a kind. I don't believe that everyone is going to be able to make tons and tons of money off of a newsletter. So my question for you is, what differentiates someone like you, who's had tremendous success, versus the everyday person that's sort of looking to build a newsletter to potentially make a career out of it, but maybe not?
Well, I think there's a couple of challenges for anyone building a newsletter. I don't necessarily think you need some extraordinarily rare set of skills to do it, but I do think you need to overcome some hurdles. One is, when you're doing an independent newsletter, you don't have the support and the input of a whole newsroom. So you've got to get to a point where you're generating your own ideas, which might be a little easier when you've been in the space, when you've been writing. Obviously, not all newsletters are about news, but that's what we're primarily discussing here. But whatever you're writing about, really to generate that work. And the other thing is finding the audience. So I didn't start with any kind of email list, but I did have a following on Twitter, and I did have some exposure to people who had been reading my work over a period of years. So if you didn't come in with that, it's going to be a challenge. And then as the space gets more crowded, when I started even 2.5 years ago, there weren't that many political newsletters, at least not in the way that I was trying to create mine. As it gets more crowded, how do you differentiate? So you have all of those challenges. I think they can be overcome. I don't think we've reached the peak of where we can go with newsletters, but I don't think it it's easy and you just sign up and create a Substack or use whatever format, and all of a sudden, you know, the subscribers and the money starts rolling and you've really got to work and grind at it. And, you know, for me, I enjoy it. I like working on my own. I like being in control of what I'm going to write and what I think is interesting. And so it's not a terrible process for me, but it's also not an easy process.
I just want to follow up on that. So you have said before, it's not that you need a massive audience, but you need a loyal, dedicated audience that's willing to pay. I think a lot of people have a misconception of just how many people you need to be loyal enough to pay. Can you walk us through that dynamic a little bit?
Yeah, and I think that is something that people talk a lot about. And I think Alex really hit the nail on the head when he says, you're really not competing against other newsletters. You're really competing against anything else that people could buy in the information space or even beyond. And you don't necessarily have to get that many people. You know, if you have 2,000 people who are paying, now it's not easy to get even one person to pay, but if you can get 2,000 people to pay, that's a pretty good income for a single person if they're paying, say, $50 a year. If you can get 10,000 people to pay, then you're starting to talk about, you know, some more serious money. None of that is easy, but it's not like you have to become the next Netflix in order to support yourself. And you don't necessarily have to appeal to that many people. And that's really where the art of it comes in, is carving out a niche for yourself that's big enough for you to grow and thrive, but not so big that you're butting heads up against, you know, the New York Times or something else who's going to be able to serve some sort of broader need more effectively.
That's a great segue in figuring out the niche, because Millie, you have a niche audience baked into the fact that you are a local publisher with the Texas Tribune. However, local can be sliced and diced in 10,000 ways. You can be like a chalk beat and focus on local education. You could focus on local dining. How does the Texas Tribune think about going niche with newsletters, or is a broad strategy more effective?
I was thinking a lot about this panel, and you know, a lot of these conversations around newsletters reminds me of just kind of the broader conversations around revenue for media organizations, right? And it's like the best way to have a sustainable, profitable media organization is to have many streams of revenue. And I feel the same strategy with newsletters, right? So if I'm looking at the Texas Tribune's newsletter portfolio, we have a lot of different offerings. We do have kind of broad, everything you need to know about like what's happening in Texas today, that hits that general audience that you're talking about. But we also have a very niche product in the Blast, which is a paid newsletter product that's specifically for people who really need to know like everything that's happening in the Texas State House, right? So whether that's like personnel moves, chairmanships, appointments, whatever it is. That's two very broad strokes. One is that broad audience you're talking about. One is that niche. And we have several automated newsletters in between, right? So these are just like topic tag RSS generated newsletters. Whereas like on both other ends, they're very much handcrafted. So it's been like, you know, I've worked in newsletters for about a decade or so. And what makes a good newsletter product hasn't changed. But I think what we're seeing is, you know, obviously all the technology and monetization opportunities. I think having a diversified strategy is really helpful. And I'll stop there.
I do want to follow up with you though. How do you decide which newsletters you're going to put behind a paywall and you think you can get people to pay for versus which ones are free? Because I'd imagine at the local level, there's a lot of information that's unique enough to what you do that people would be willing to pay. But then again, you don't want to box people out.
Yeah, and I think the difference here, right, is we are a nonprofit news organization. So again, I haven't focused on newsletters specifically in a long time, but more about newsletters in a broader audience and organizational strategy. So, you know, Alex, I think you mentioned like newsletters as content marketing, right? And I think of it less as content marketing, but it really is about introducing your brand, who you are as a news organization, to people. And we do have that kind of top of the funnel, this is kind of broad, everything you need to know, one-stop shop. And then we have the very niche, narrow audience, right? Judd, this is kind of to your point about making something specific enough with the small enough, but big enough, viable enough audience to have them pay for it. So I think it's a combination. And I think depending on the size and maturity of your organization, you'll kind of pick and choose, right? And I think it's great that we have the option to pick and choose with such ease because the product and technology is available. I think it is very much about having a diversified portfolio and figuring out what works best for you. I should also say we don't have the luxury of just going to totally niche, narrow, paid because we have that public service mission. So I think it's really important to have that public service journalism available for free and have all these other things to support that, again, as a broader kind of organizational strategy.
I want to come back to the public service mission focus of what you're doing, because that differentiates you not just on this panel, but also from a lot of news organizations out there. Let's go back to Alex really quickly. When you first launched Morning Brew, it was one big morning newsletter. And to Millie's point, you kind of found niches, whether it was marketing or retail, to branch into. How do you decide which niches make the most sense for your audience? And I don't want you to divulge anything, but are there other sort of niches that y'all are eyeing in the future?
Yeah, for sure. It's a great question. And to Millie's point and to Judd's point, I think this concept of going niche is, the reason that it really has picked up steam is, I think, to their point, people are realizing that, one, with your content, you need to serve a very specific purpose. You need to solve a problem or you need to serve a passion. And it's easier to do that when you're talking about something very specific. When you're talking about something that is general interest in nature, it's hard to serve a passion around general interest content. And, the way we've always thought about it at Morning Brew is we started with our daily newsletter, right? Which went a mile wide and an inch deep. And what we always said was this was kind of like the top of the T. It was the horizontal part where we were casting a wide net, we were building a top of funnel, but it was always the most general we would go because to their points, we wanted to serve specific passions or purposes and help people do their jobs better in the workplace. And so the way we've always decided our niches is a combination of a few things. One is, with our 2.6 million person top of funnel with the daily newsletter, one question we always ask is like, what do those people do? What job functions do they work in? What industries do they work in? Because it's great to have a head start when you can have 100,000 people join a list on day one because they work in that industry. The second is, what is an industry or job function that has enough news flow to support at least being a 3-day-a-week newsletter where you can build habit around it? If there's not enough content, I think building habit around something that's once a week or less frequent is generally very difficult. The third is, to Millie's point, we always think about how are we going to set ourselves up to diversify revenue, but we kind of assume the worst case scenario with all of our B2B verticals. And we say, if advertising is the only way to monetize, does a specific vertical have enough depth of advertiser money who wants to get in front of this audience that it could support this business and be a profitable business? So those are the big three, to give you a sense of what are other verticals we're thinking about. We haven't landed on what vertical four is. We will later this year, but a few that we're thinking about are healthcare, real estate, crypto, cannabis, and things that are more like function specific, like HR. And so we haven't made the decision yet or pulled the trigger, but those are a few that are kind of sitting in our wheelhouse that we're studying further.
I'm so excited to see which ones you pick, and I will be a quick subscriber to whichever ones you roll out. Judd, let's go to you really fast. One of the things that's distinct about popular information is that you actually break news. In a sense, you're an investigative journalist, and that helps you to build audience and go viral. To what extent does breaking news in a newsletter help to build an audience? And do you absolutely need to break news in order to do it?
I don't think you need to. I think there's a lot of successful newsletters that don't do that. Probably the most successful newsletter on Substack right now is by a professor. I'm now blanking on her name. Cox Richardson is her last name. But anyway, she She just writes a summary from a historical perspective of what's happening in the news, doesn't break any news, and she's doing better than anyone else. I have found that the incentives for me align. I like digging into a lot of the news that I'm breaking is based on public records. I like digging into FEC filings and the like. And the incentives align. When you do something that has a broader impact that gets picked up in other outlets, that increases the exposure to your newsletter. And anytime your exposure increases, you'll get more free signups. And my model is, 100% subscription model. I don't have advertising, but I do know pretty consistently that if someone signs up, a certain percentage of those people are going to convert over. So the more people that sign up, the better it is for my business. So that's one of the things that's really, and I didn't know this moving in, which is why I've increased the amount of original reporting I've done as I've gone through this process, is the stuff that I really like to do, which is the original reporting, actually is the best thing for the business as well. So over time, I've cut out as many other things as I could, so I can focus on that, because that's what I want to do. And it's also what grows the newsletter. Because as I mentioned in my first answer, that's really the fundamental challenge, especially when you don't have another brand or a whole operation behind you. It's how do you get anyone to even know that you're doing this and getting mentioned by people who already have an audience, which you can do by breaking news, is a very effective way of doing that.
Yes, we have cited you multiple times at Axios for some of your breaking news.
And I appreciate that.
Quickly, just to follow up, how do you figure out format when you're thinking about your newsletter? Because I find that sometimes when I'm reading it, it can be very broken up in the way that you add quotes or you add filing information versus your own analysis and text. What is the cadence by which you're thinking about, graphics or texts or quotes? And is there something that you found works better than others?
When I first started it, I knew that there were so many really good political newsletters that kind of had a bite-sized rundown of everything that was happening. Axios has several, Politico has them. Now there's even more with Punchbowl. So I knew I wasn't going to do that. And initially, I was doing maybe three topics, but I found that more and more it was going into one topic and that's what people were liking. So I've really settled on one topic. I like to keep it like 1500 words is kind of my guidepost. Like sometimes it's 1,000 words, sometimes it's 2000, but I'm hitting in that range because I think that's a range where people can read the whole thing. People have time to read the whole thing in 5 minutes. And then as far as graphics and quotes and things like that, I'm really just trying to make the most succinct, compelling presentation of the information I have available, and I let that determine it. So sometimes it's just a narrative that I write. Sometimes I'm doing pretty large block quotes. Sometimes I'm putting in images, but that's really just about, I'm kind of envisioning my reader. I've got 5 minutes of their time, and how can I really create something that's exciting and that makes them feel more informed after they read?
I love that 1500 word threshold, because that is the threshold that we use at Axios as well for our weekly newsletters. Millie, let's turn over to you. Some of the stuff that the Texas Tribune puts out is of interest to me in Washington, D.C. Some of it is way too local for me to be paying attention to. When you're thinking about newsletters, but also some of the other new products that you're putting out, how much are you trying to figure out whether or not you can broaden your audience to be national versus making sure you're staying hyper-local to that public service mission that you referenced?
That's a great question, and kind of gets to the heart of, this past year, where I think several news organizations across the board saw record growth following news of the coronavirus. Everyone, I think, saw like double-digit growth. I think we're still figuring out that growth, right? It's like very much an active and live conversation for us. Like, we started off, we're about 10 years old now, 11 years old. And we started off as very much like largest statehouse bureau. We're going to cover the Texas Capitol and like everything going on. And now, we've always had that public service mission. We, allow any other publisher to republish our story, so there's more journalism about Texas in Texas. But what we're seeing is that you know, that public service mission actually goes well beyond like just like policy and politics as we traditionally think about it, right? And Judd, like you said, that space is crowded. And just talking about, just thinking about kind of newsletters that deliver, it was so interesting to me to hear you talk, because I think what this period has shown us is that we've all become like product thinkers. The way you talked about how you put your newsletter together was very much incorporating like the design, the user experience, kind of the competitive analysis needed. So Sarah, back to your question, we're still figuring it out. And I think the trick is to, you know, I think the holy grail of all of this is to be able to make a niche thing interesting to more people than it actually affects and touches directly, right? So if you can make something interesting that you would have just found to be too Texas for you to pay attention to, but if we can make that interesting, like Texas is one of the biggest states and consequential states in the US. And I think, you know, my aspiration for the Texas Tribune is to lean into that, right? Like, I think, you know, we always hear like, there goes Texas, there goes like the US, right? And I think as much as we can make that connection and make Texas interesting to people who live there, but also that this actually affects people like outside of its borders, it's really interesting. And it kind of goes to that kind of T shape, right? Because there are issues of healthcare, of immigration, of like incarceration that have nationwide effects and implications, but don't just affect Texas, but we can tell it through that Texas lens.
I wish someone would say that about my home state, where New Jersey goes, the country goes, but I've never heard that said before.
Best state in the country.
We can make it happen.
We can make it happen. Well, starting a New Jersey newsletter right after this panel. Alex, let's go to you. So your company sold, Axios reported that, to Business Insider, now called Insider, which is owned by Axel Springer, last year. And it was really noteworthy because it was one of the first big newsletter-focused acquisitions. We're now seeing a bunch of them, right? I reported last week that The Hustle was bought by HubSpot. So walk us through sort of the M&A landscape for newsletters. Do you think we're going to continue to see a flurry of newsletter companies rise and get bought up? Do you think companies are eyeing people like Judd, that they can just acquire the person and hope to transport their newsletter into their company? And what's the benefit of doing that?
Yeah, so it's a great question. It's something I think about a lot. So in terms of newsletters, you know, my answer would be there's probably going to be a handful more that happen over the next, you know, 12 to 24 months. I do think it's more limited than people think, because going back to our original point of like, you need to actually build a real quality scaled audience to justify, you know, a big business or a business that can be bought. You need to build a quality audience. And I would say there aren't that many newsletters that have built at scale quality audiences. Like I can probably only think of 5 to 10 at the top of my head. Then you start talking about people like Judd, who have built incredible audiences and businesses in themselves. I think the hard thing about that is like, what is Judd's incentive to sell to a larger company or to be rolled up into a holding company of Substackers, this rebundling of the unbundle? And I think the incentive is pretty low. I'm sure Judd is really loving his life right now. He's making good money that makes him feel good about financial security. He gets to run on his own schedule, creating content, what he wants to create content around. Like to me, whenever I've thought about my career, it's like I have my non-negotiables in life, like the 4 or 5 things I need to be settled in what I'm doing. And again, I don't know Judd well enough to know for sure that he's feeling these, but my guess is he feels pretty good about them. And so I think that's the hard thing about rolling up individuals is, like he said, you don't have to get that many paid subscribers to have financial independence and do exactly what you want to do. And so I guess the question becomes, what is any of these individuals' incentives to not just continue doing what you want to do?
This is a perfect segue, both to Judd and to Millie. Let's start with Millie, because Millie, I know that Texas Tribune actually did this. It kind of rolled up some existing writers to launch its newsletter product. So I'm going to go first to you, and I want to ask about why you did that and whether it was successful. And then Judd, I want to take you next. Millie?
Thanks. That's a great question. And this is a teeny bit of Tribune history. When Evan Smith and John Thornton were starting the Tribune, they basically, you know, John Thornton was an investor. Evan Smith was executive editor of Texas Monthly at the time, they didn't really have someone on the inside, like in the Capitol, roaming the hallways, someone who they knew, like everyone would take their call and would always read, right? And so they kind of surveyed everyone and said, who do you read? Who do you go to? And, you know, overwhelmingly, they said Ross Ramsey, who now is our executive editor and was one of the co-founders of the Texas Tribune. And Ross Ramsey used to do his own newsletter. This was like 10 years ago, right? Called Texas Weekly. And we basically, because that overwhelming response and answer was Ross Ramsey, we read him, we'll read everything he writes. We essentially acqui-hired him to get his newsletter and him. So, you know, that like nugget from, again, 10 years ago, just reminds me that like a lot of these trends are cyclical. And a lot of what's changing is the kind of tech and media scaffolding that are enabling us to like do the journalism, do the content, where we can make money. And whether that's through ads, there are a lot of interesting things going on through like this product called Letterhead by Wear by Us. They do a bunch of local newsletters. It's really interesting to see what they're doing to make kind of the process of programmatic ads invisible. So like people can focus on just writing the journal, like writing the newsletter. So again, I share that to say, a lot of things I think, like a lot of these trends are not new. What makes a good newsletter has not changed much, but it's kind of all the things that the tech has made possible now.
I love what you said about the acqui-hire. I've never really heard about it in that sense, but that's a great term. Judd, let's go to you. If someone, a newsroom came to you and said, you are so unique, we want to cover political influence, no one does it like you, what would it take to have you consider that offer? What are the things, to Alex's point, that you need to have satisfied to make you happy? Or is there no bounds? You will never go to a newsroom. You like staying independent.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I would never rule out anything definitively, but I can say that I would be exceedingly unlikely to join a newsroom, mostly because I really place a huge value on the independence of being on my own, where I get to set my own schedule, I get to set my own cadence, and I get total autonomy to set the topic. Part of the reason why I started this newsletter in the first place was I was running a newsroom, and I was just tired of the bureaucracy of being a part of a larger organization and wanted to really get into writing and reporting again. And that's what I found. I do have a research assistant now, so I have a very small, tiny two-person organization, but I'm happy with that. I feel like I can grow. The business still is growing. So if someone's going to value it right now, they're going to value it where it currently sits. And I think in 5 years, I'll be in a much better place than I am now, because I think that I'm going to do some good reporting by then. I think some more people will find out about it and more people will sign up. So I'm very happy. I don't see a lot of benefit in sort of the rolling up. I think that that's something that on the reader side people talk about, but they're going to have to work out how that benefits the writers as well, because right now, being independent has a lot of value, I think, to myself and a lot of the other writers who are pursuing, you know, similar models.
Yeah, I can see some of the tensions that you're talking about in terms of autonomy. Axios is somewhat of a roll-up if you think about it. We've taken a bunch of experts and given them all newsletters, but we do have to do a lot of coordination, especially when is my editor awake and when can they help me get things across the finish line? Just as we are wrapping up, I wanted to come to you as, you know, sort of experts and professionals in the field. If you could each provide for our audience one or maybe two newsletters that you highly recommend, hopefully maybe we can help to build their audiences as much as we build yours. So Alex, let's start with you. Any newsletters that you recommend to the audience?
Yep. And sorry, putting that to the side for a second. I'm going to break your rule and do three. Ben Thompson on technology and analyzing technology companies and the strategy behind them. Matt Levine at Bloomberg, I would pay for his newsletter if you made it paid. And Webb Smith, who writes 2 p.m. around like retail and e-commerce. He does an exceptional job as well.
I love all of those newsletters. Millie, what about you?
I feel like I read too many newsletters for too long. So read many more like individual newsletters now. I'm a big fan of Anne Helen Peterson's Substack. I like Hunter Harris's Substack. I love seeing all these journalists kind of do their own thing. Haley Nauman's. I also love the kind of shift from, you know, a lot of what we was like tiny letter back in the day to Substack and being able to support these journalists I have always liked. I also love Margins by Ranjan Roy and Ken Durek. They're so smart about kind of media technology and all things. And I think just provide like a really great outside, like insider outsider perspective.
Totally. And I love and Helen as well. So I'm very happy that you said that. Judd, let's go to you. Any newsletter recommendations?
Yeah, I'll recommend two other Substacks since that's my particular platform. Heated by Emily Atkin is a newsletter that's focused on climate. That's, you know, fairly similar to mine in that it focuses on accountability journalism, but really laser focused on climate and is great. And also Luke O'Neill, who writes a newsletter called Welcome to Hell World, which I think is a really good example of a newsletter that could not exist with any in any publication, just because he's kind of a gonzo journalist, but is really interesting and I think very fitting for the times that we are living in.
Perfect. Thank you all so much for taking some time. We are very excited and to really hopefully catch up with you maybe next year in person at South by Southwest. Before I let the audience go, I want to just do a quick wrap of some of the things that we learned today. I love, Alex, what you said, that competing for quality content is the goal, not necessarily competing against other newsletters. I know, Judd, you said you feel the same way. I like that you said that you don't have the chat, you know, the support of a whole newsroom when you're going independent, but you have a lot of other advantages. You set your own schedule, for example, and you are able to dictate all of the editorial content without anyone else's input. Millie, one of the things that is unique to the Texas Tribune, but also in some cases to local, is figuring out which newsletters you put in front of the paywall versus which newsletters you put behind the paywall. But one of the important things about ones that are free is that they're really critical for branding. And that's important to a 10-year-old, 11-year-old newsroom like the Texas Tribune. Alex, 2.6 million people at the top of the funnel in your main newsletter. That's an incredible tool that you're using to build out some of your other newsletters. And in the future, you're eyeing things like healthcare, real estate, crypto, cannabis, and potentially job-specific functions like HR. Judd, you don't need to break news to be successful, is what you said, but breaking news has been a very important strategy for you because folks like me cite you all the time and we're grateful for the things you uncover. You said your newsletters are around 1,500 words. That seems to be Axios' sweet spot as well. Millie, I like that you said that you did an acqui-hire in order to build your first big newsletter product with Ross Ramsey. I'm going to be subscribing to his newsletter today. I haven't gotten it before. And I want to also share the newsletter recommendations that you all provided, which were excellent. Alex says to check a look at Ben Thompson, who does tech, Matt Levine at Bloomberg, and Webb Smith, 2 p.m., Judd says Heated by Emily Atkin is critical for climate, as well as Luke O'Neill. You wouldn't get that in a traditional newsroom. And Millie, Hunter Harris, Anne Helen Peterson. And I like what you said, Millie, at the end about you're seeing this shift from sort of the tiny letter world into Substack. I hope that we could see more of that in the future. Thank you so, so much to all of you for joining in. Thank you to South By for having us. And again, we hope to see you in person in 2022. Thank you.